Hello, First Church family and friends, and welcome to worship. Psalm 90, which we will read in just a little bit, but it begins like this. I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Lord Most High. Let that be what this time is for. To give thanks within our hearts to God, to claim the wonderful works of the Lord, and to sing God's praises as a community. So may God bless us as we begin this worship by singing the song, God of the Ages.
Thank you. A reading from Psalms, the 9th chapter, verses 11 through 20. Sing praises to the Lord who dwells in Zion. Tell among the peoples God's deeds. The Lord who avenges blood is mindful of them and does not forget the cry of the afflicted. Be gracious to me, O Lord. See what I suffer from those who hate me. You are the one who lifts me up from the gates of death, that I may recount all your praises, and in the gates of the daughter of Zion, rejoice in your deliverance. The nations have sank in the pit which they made. Their own foot has been caught in the net which they hid. The Lord is made known. The Lord has executed judgment. The wicked are shared in the work of their own hands. The wicked shall depart to Sheol, all the nations that forget God. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, and the hope of the poor shall not perish forever. Arise, O Lord, let not mortals prevail. Let the nations be judged before you. Put them in fear, O Lord. Let the nations know that they are mortal. This ends the reading of our scripture this morning. Now let us gather our hearts in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before you this morning very grateful. Very grateful that we are once again able to gather in person. We thank you for the vaccine which has enabled this recovery. And we also, Father, pray that it would continue to be spread throughout the world, that we might be able to put an end to this devastation, loss of life. Just when we begin to become normal, Father, we sometimes forget you. So keep us steadfast in constantly being reminded of you and your love for us. Let us remember those that continue to heal from COVID, that are traumatized, as those folks in Miami that had that building collapse. Those that are ill, Father. Those that are hungry and thirsty. Those that are lonely or confined. And those that are running from you, Lord. We remember them all. Guide us all through every day and lead us to our ministry, to others for you. We ask all of these things, Lord, through Jesus Christ. And now please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go in peace.
Our story for today has become a very widely known story throughout our Judeo-Christian history, as well as across many cultures. It is revered and referenced so many times, and we see this story replayed in the stories and movies even of our day and age. It is the age-old story of the big guy versus the little guy, the story of the victory of the underdog. Some movies that you might know that we might see this played out in would be like Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark, or Star Wars with Luke versus Darth Vader, and then the basketball movie Hoosiers, about the underdog small town basketball team who ends up winning state. Our story today is where that metaphor came from. Our story today has been made into a metaphor that we use for improbable victories of a weak party over a much stronger party. We say it was a David and Goliath story, and we know what that means. It not only refers to the original David and Goliath story, but it talks about that underlying story of the underdog's victory. So let's listen once more to this story, a familiar story, but let's hear it with fresh ears. From 1 Samuel, chapter 17, verses 32 to 49, hear this word of the Lord. David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You're not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. You are only a young man, and he has become a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around because he was not used to them. "I cannot go in these," he said to Saul, "because I'm not used to them." So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with his sling in his hand, approached the Philistine. Meanwhile, the Philistine, with his shield bearer in front of him, kept coming closer to David. He looked David over and saw that he was little more than a boy, glowing with health and handsome, and he despised him. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come at me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals." David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands." As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out his stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The story of the underdog seems to be a favorite story of God's. It is, after all, the story of the Israelite slaves being rescued from the strength of the Egyptian army. It is the story of Daniel in the lion's den, the story of Elijah versus Queen Jezebel and all the hundreds of prophets of Baal. It's the story of that we hear sung by Hannah, the mother of Samuel, and then years later sung by Mary, the mother of Jesus. It's the story that Jesus declares in the Beatitudes, and it's the story of Jesus's resurrection. This story is the story of God's heart. And so it's an important thing for us to think about, not just the story, but also who are the characters within the story? And what can we learn about ourselves when we look at the characters in this age-old, timeless story? God's favorite story. Well, in this particular depiction of the age-old story, our first character is the picture of false bravado. Of course, I'm talking about Goliath. He is picked out of the army of the Philistines for one reason and one reason only, is because he is huge. He stands heads above the rest of the armies, and he is the one to enter into the battle. You see, the Philistine army and the Israelite army, they were kind of at a stalemate. They were on either side of this valley. And the stalemate was because of this. The Philistines over here and the Israelites over here, if any one of them charged, you have to come down the valley. And once you come down the valley, you're just a target. There's no way to escape. The other army has the upper hand, and you will be destroyed. And so they're at a stalemate with the valley between them. And so they decide that we'll just send one man down from each army. They'll fight it out, and whichever man wins, that army wins the battle. So, of course, it was natural that the Philistines would send Goliath down to be their person because he's so huge. He's what we call a giant, if you will. But you gotta wonder, why all the armor? Why all the armor? If he's so big and so tough, why does he need so much armor? armor. The scripture says that he has a helmet of bronze, a coat of mail, and then bronze shin guards. All of that, at least the coat of mail alone, probably weighed 150 pounds. And then on top of that, on top of all of that armor that just covers him, he also has a spear with a spearhead that weighs 19 pounds. It seems like overkill, doesn't it? If he is already so big and imposing and has so much strength, why does he need so much armor? Well, it might be he needs so much armor because the very source of Goliath's strength may also be the source of his greatest weakness. Goliath actually has a false or conditional bravado. It's interesting. I've done a little bit of studying around this, and for years now, the actual medical field has done some research, and it's been picked up by theologians and biblical scholars as well, about giantism. And what we know now is that a condition of a tumor that presses on or grows on the pituitary gland. The pituitary gland is what creates growth hormones in our bodies, and this tumor makes even more growth hormones flooded into the body, and so the body grows so much and so strong. But because of the pituitary gland as well, being invaded by that tumor, eyesight can be impaired. And this may be what's going on with Goliath. He might not be able to see very clearly. He might have actually double vision. David, it clearly says David picked up his staff, but when Goliath sees David, he says, "Am I a dog that you come after me with sticks?" So he might see more than one stick when David only has the one staff. He might actually see more than one David, if you will. It says how he is led down the hill and into the valley by his shield bearer. It might be that he's also saying, "Come to me," because he doesn't know where to go himself. He might really be visually impaired because of what makes him strong and big might also have given him an impairment as well. So with that, someone is going to have to get close to him in order for him to defeat them. He's going to have to get up close and personal, and if he sees more than one person, that could be a problem. So thus he needs that armor because he doesn't know where the blow might be coming from. That might be why he needs that armor. We might find ourselves like Goliath at times in our faith journey. We might feel like we have all the tools, that we have all of the knowledge, but we're unable to see clearly. We might have a lot of faith knowledge. We might know a lot about the Bible. We might attend church regularly. We might have the look of a confident Christian, but that doesn't mean that we don't miss the point at times. Having all of that doesn't mean that we really have the heart of faith as well. And that is what helps us to see. The heart of faith helps us to see clearly. We might have all the strength of all that knowledge and all that experience, but with a heart that helps us to see, that may be our weak point. I remember a time when I was first kind of a brand new Christian, and I was first engaged in church, and I had this heart awakening, and I was following the Lord, and I was just on on the mountaintop. And the Sunday after Christmas at church, someone who, a longtime Christian, much longer, many more years than myself, and very learned, said to me, "So what did you get for Christmas?" And I said, from the sincerity of my heart, I said, "I got a Savior." And this man looked at me and he said, "Don't get all high and mighty with me." And I've never forgotten that. I wasn't trying to be snarky with him at all. It was that I was just so simply joyful that I was celebrating Christmas probably for the first time, not because of the presents I was getting or anything like that, but I was celebrating the fact of a Savior being born. And I wonder about that individual with all their knowledge, with all of their years of experience, with all of that, that they could not see the joy within my heart of the reality of the gospel. Well, next we have a picture of foreboding failure. Now, this isn't David. There's actually another person in this story, another large character in this particular story that we do need to pay attention to. Not David, but rather King Saul. King Saul was the natural opponent to Goliath. It says in Scripture, in 1 Samuel 9, Saul is described as being a head taller than anyone else. He's so much taller than everyone else that he would be the natural opponent. He would be, you see, Goliath coming down the mountain, he would be the natural opponent. More so than anyone else in his army, he would be the opponent to Goliath because he had the stature more than anyone else to take on Goliath. But the story says, when Saul and all Israel heard the words of Goliath, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. And what's happening here is that Saul is carrying on his ancestors' fear. Carrying on his ancestors' fear. If we go back in the story, we will remember that the Israelites who were freed from Egypt and they were in the wilderness, and when they made it to the promised land and there were spies that went out to spy out the promised land, all of those spies came back. 10 of the 12 said, "There's giants in the land." 2 of the 12, Caleb and Joshua, said, "We can do this. We need to move forward with this." But everybody heard the voice of the 10 and said, "We don't want to go in there. There might be giants." And so they didn't. They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. And then when their descendants made it into the promised land, well, they pushed back everybody that was there. They subdued, they took over the land, but they failed in completely subduing the Philistines. And so what we have here is that we have Goliath, which is he's kind of a remnant giant. He's a remnant of those ancient folks from a long time ago. Saul's refusal to fight Goliath is a sign of Israel's previous and ongoing failure. And it's also a foreshadowing of Saul's future failure. He had a failure to trust. He had a failure of faith. Saul was continuing in his fear, he was continuing in the failure of his ancestors. Might we sometimes find ourselves like Saul? We might. Any time that we place our trust in our own strength or in our own abilities or in our own understandings or in our own knowledge, we might find ourselves lacking. And if that's all we're trusting in, then we will fear and we will fail. Any time that we fail to trust in God's provisions, any time that we fail to trust in Jesus' teachings, any time that we fail to trust in God's promises, any time that we fail to believe in God's mission in this world, we live like Saul, quaking, paralyzed, and unable to move forward. So that's the second character in this timeless story. We have the story, the picture of false bravado. We have the picture of foreboding failure. And then finally, we have the picture of unswerving faith. And you guys know that this is about David, of course. Our third character in the story, David remembers. David's the one who watches this. He enters in late to the story, and he sees the armies at a stalemate. He sees Goliath, you know, casting his taunts and saying, "Send me someone." And David's like, "I'll go. Put me in, coach," right? David remembers that. He's like, "Hey, wait a minute. Who's this guy think he is? We are the army of the living God. Who does this guy think he is? He doesn't stand a chance if we remember who we are." David understood who he was and who he wasn't. He refused to wear Saul's armor. Saul tried to dress him up in his own mail and sword and shield and all of this stuff, and David couldn't walk around in it. He's like, "This isn't me. I can't do this." And so he takes all that garb off, and he remembers who he is. He says, "Wait a minute. I have some skills here of my own. You know, God has given me some strength in the past to do what I need to do." And so he believed that God would bless him as well in this situation. David understood who he was and who he wasn't. And then he takes up what seems to be the smallest, the seemingly inferior weapon, which of course targets Goliath's biggest weakness. David knew, he entered. He knew the battle wasn't his. If he won, the victory wouldn't be because of his strength. Just like he said that God had given him the victory over the bear and the lion, he would win not because of his height. He would win not because of his armor or his weapons, but he would win because the Lord would have stepped in. And we find ourselves like David whenever we remember who we are, that we are baptized and we are redeemed by Jesus. This is our identity. And because of that, we are part of a covenant community. We remember who we are, just like David remembered who he was. Whenever we remember that our victory, like David's, has already been won by God. Jesus says, "I have already overcome the world." He said that before he ever went to the cross. He says, "I have overcome the world." His victory was promised. Paul affirmed it as well in 1 Corinthians. We read in chapter 15, he writes, "Death has been swallowed up in a victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" We are like David when we know that the victory's already been won by God. We are like David every time that we remember that God's favorite story of the underdog's victory, that's our story as well. It's a story in which the underdog always makes room for God to be God. It's a big story. It's a remembered story. It's God's favorite story. And it is also our story, because our biggest enemy has already been defeated by Jesus. God bless you as you claim that. God bless you as you live into it. God bless you as you live with unswerving faith. Amen. Before we close, one big announcement I want to share. This Tuesday night will be our special church conference that we call every year to do two particular pieces of business. One is to pass our next fiscal year's budget, which we will do on Tuesday night, and then also to elect our leadership for the next fiscal year as well, which we will do on Tuesday night. This year we have another big agenda item for this Tuesday night, and that is to consider a potential building purchase for the preschool. So we have a lot of information to share. A lot of it has been sent out through the e-news. All of our church members are invited to participate and to have voice and vote at this meeting. It's Tuesday night, June 29th, 7 o'clock in the church sanctuary. And so now let us remember as we go forth that as the scripture says, some people put their trust in chariots and some people put their trust in horses. Some people put their trust in the strengths of this world, but we put our trust in the Lord. So whatever you're facing, whatever you're going through these days, may you find strength in the Lord's promises and may you trust in them. God bless you. See you next week.